And what we've been discussing the last few classes is the Passover feast, which has included the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And I want to bring in this factor of, of hyssop. And we discussed it a little bit that when they were in Egypt, they were required to put the blood on the door. We talked about that. We talked about the fact that they were required to eat the lamb, not just kill a lamb. In other words, not just have Jesus crucified for them, but they were required to eat the lamb. But one factor we didn't mention that is involved with that is how to apply the blood. And the way that the scriptures told Israel to do that was that they were to take a piece of hyssop, and it is a plant, and they were to dip it in the blood, and then they were to put it with the hyssop on the doorposts. And so I want to look at that, and I want you to see in Psalm 51. This psalm is a really, really good psalm, and this is the situation after David and Bathsheba and David and Uriah the Hittite. He had him killed, and then he ended up marrying Bathsheba. And it is his repentance psalm over that. Notice Psalm 51 and verse 6 and 7. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. So there is this factor we talk about being washed in the blood. Washed in the blood, and that's a real common phrase that we're used to. And so David mentions, wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. And there's many songs written about the blood washing us whiter than snow. But the thing that we usually leave out is in this same verse, it says, purge me with hyssop. And this whole fact that David is not, he's not celebrating the Passover in this psalm. He's not carrying out a Jewish ritual. When he says, purge me with hyssop, David, maybe more than anybody else in the Old Testament, David has found the personal meaning to the rituals. He has found reality beyond religion and rituals. And so he says, purge me with hyssop, wash me in your blood, and I will be whiter than snow. And of course, again, the hyssop was a branch, a certain kind of branch that was taken, and the blood was applied with hyssop so that you almost can't separate hyssop from the blood. And yet most Christians know almost nothing about hyssop or the application of it because they have not found the New Testament as the living fulfillment of the old. The blood is just a factor brought into New Testament saints. Jesus died on a cross for us. They don't see that as a sacrifice that was fulfilled in the old covenant. And so they leave parts of it out. But hyssop relates to attitudes and to actions. The blood relates to just the fact of Jesus shedding his blood. But the attitude that we carry out our tasks is every bit as important as the thing that we do. And, you know, and there's many people think that virtue is found in simply doing the right thing. In other words, there are right actions and wrong actions, which could be the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But they think that there are only certain actions. There are only certain actions that are right. And that those actions in and of themselves are virtuous. When in reality, and we'll get into that with hyssop, in reality, there are many actions carried out. For Israel, for example, who celebrated the feasts and who gave sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and all of this stuff. And God says to Israel, who's doing all of this stuff, who's doing the right action, I hate your burnt offering. I hate your new moons. I hate your celebrations. And you go, well, wait a minute. You're the one who told us to do this. And it's because they've lost the spirit of what's going on. So, and besides, right actions usually include doing certain acts in the external realm, such as something that is, you know, helping someone or being involved in a godly activity or accomplishing some task for the Lord, that those things in and of themselves, in other words, we might see going to the mission on a short-term mission trip as more of God than staying back. When a person may stay back for reasons that are of the Lord, but we see that activity as godly in and of itself. And I've been on many short-term mission trips, and folks, I've been with people that there's nothing virtuous in them coming on the trip. I mean, it was not good, you know. They had nothing of the Lord, nor were they really interested in bringing the Lord, but they went. And, you know, you can mark it on your belt, you know, you can put a notch in your belt. I went to this country now. I went to this country, you know, I went here. Yeah, but how much of it was the Lord in attitude? Maybe none. So David says this. Basically, this is my paraphrase. God is concerned with our inward parts just as much as he is concerned with the outward parts. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts thou shalt make me know wisdom. Turn with me over to, since we're right here in Psalm 37. Here is just a whole lot of different things. The whole thing is this, but if you look beginning with verse 3, trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust in him, he shall bring it to pass. Verse 6, and he shall bring forth righteousness as light, and thy justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Most of these, we end up catching the second half, such as thou shalt dwell in the land, and thou shalt be fed. He will give you the desires of your heart. He shall bring it to pass. The first part relates to an attitude towards the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Delight thyself in the Lord. Commit thy way. Rest in the Lord. All of these things are heart conditions. They're not actions. They're a situation of how you are towards the Lord. And that's what he's most concerned with. That's where his heart is. And, you know, from many scriptures that you're familiar with in the New Testament, you know, God wants his son formed in us. Let's look at a scripture in Philippians. And something you may not have noticed here in Philippians chapter 3. Philippians 3 and verse 7 and 8. It says, "But what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." God wants Christ formed in us. God wants, this is not information you're not familiar with, God desires that all that we do, that we do it as branches to the vine, and we allow his life to flow through us. Everybody agree with that? However, before Christ is ever formed in us, God will require a humbling of us. Before Christ is ever formed in us to do those things, God will require a humbling. For example, Paul counted all things loss for what? To know the Lord. In other words, you could almost say, before you come to a revelation of Christ, there has to be a committing of your way unto the Lord. Well, isn't that interesting? Because God does want everything to be Christ, but before it can be Christ, before there can be that blood, before there can be that lamb, we have to take hyssop and apply these things. There has to be this work in us before a revelation of Christ, whereby we, by our own volition, by our own commitment, will have certain actions and certain attitudes that lend themselves to finding Christ as life. Because you'll never come to a revelation of Christ just saying, well, if God wants me to have it, he'll hit me in the head with it. You know, it's not going to happen that way. You know, Paul said, I count everything lost that I may know him, you see. And so we have to become, if you will, broken. We have to become humble. And we'll have to commit ourselves to the Lord long before life is formed in us to be able to please the Father and do the things, manifest in these other ways. First, we're going to have to manifest humility and commitment on our own part, that we want the Lord, that we're committed to the Lord. You know, for years, Christianity and the faith message particularly has emphasized faith to the exclusion of everything else. Some of you know that. Many of you here don't know that. But the faith movement is just like, you know, you just have faith. You know, faith is being, you know, basically it's being presented as a strong belief in the Word of God. And if you present yourself as having any sort of a need or demonstrating any kind of a humble demeanor in when you're supposedly exercising faith, that you're actually showing a lack of faith. Like if you said, please, or, oh, Lord, I would just desire, instead of just going, well, God said it, I believe it, it's mine, that's it. Then you're showing a lack of faith if you act humble in the process or something like that. However, hyssop represents, and I'll show you that in a minute, but hyssop represents our part in the humbling process whereby this is applied, the blood is applied, forgiveness is applied, or anything else. Hyssop is very important to this, the faith people, we want to walk with our head up and never carry ourselves as confident instead of looking down or saying, oh Lord, you know, be merciful to me. You see what I'm saying? And so let's just turn to Exodus, where the example is given, Exodus chapter 12. Exodus 12 and verse 21, and here's where the scriptures actually refer to it. Exodus 12, chapter 21, or verse 21. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintels and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not permit the destroyer to come into your homes to smite you. And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. Okay? You getting that? So, here, hyssop is in relationship to forgiveness and the blood of Christ. And, you know, basically the faith crowd says, if you sin, simply ask for forgiveness in faith and then get up and act as if nothing happened. No hyssop involved. You notice what I'm saying? I mean, basically, all you needed to do is put the blood in the basin and then just throw it up there and then shout, whoopee. But God said, no, I want you to take hyssop. And, you know, I agree with faith and I agree with the application of the blood. But one of the things they fail to comprehend is the place of hyssop. And again, David, who is like, you know, thousands of years at least, you know, possibly from this point, certainly hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, David is talking about the application of hyssop in his dire situation where he has sinned and failed. Why doesn't David just exercise faith and get up? And we'll get into some examples of that in just a minute. With David, in fact, in this very situation. Let's go to Romans real quick, and I'll point out a real popular scripture here. Romans chapter 3. In verse 25, speaking of Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remissions of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. The blood is applied to the doorpost at the Passover. When the death angel saw the blood, he passed over. The main point, of course, we usually see is the blood, but God decided that wherever the blood is, it's going to be applied in a certain way, and that hyssop was meant to be the instrument by which the offerer applies that blood, responds to that blood. So anytime, and this is why David, who is depending on the Lord, says, purge me with hyssop, wash me in the blood, and I shall be whiter than snow. So he doesn't leave anything out because he understood that that old was a shadow of the true, and he was already living according to the true in a certain sense, if you understand what I mean. So hyssop in our hand, hyssop in the hand of the offerer, hyssop in the person who is going to apply the blood, he's the one who has a certain attitude, a certain brokenness, before he even gets to the blood. So to fully understand hyssop, you have to look at, you know, a couple of scriptures and just a little bit of study of the physical being of hyssop, and then you begin to understand what it really talks about, how it appears and how it grows, and factors such as this. Look in 1 Kings chapter 4. And I'll be giving you lots of scriptures to turn to, so this is good for you to get nothing else. Certain pages of your Bible will get used that hadn't ever been used, thank God. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 33. This is some of the wisdom of Solomon. In fact, verse 29 says, and God gave Solomon wisdom and very much understanding and largeness of heart, even as the sand that is on the seashore. So if you drop all the way down, or just a few verses down to verse 33. It's talking about all the things that he spoke of. For, well, 32, and he spoke 3,000 proroverbs, and his songs were 1,005. So you think Cassie or Kelly's written a lot of songs, or even Sarah. Solomon, you know, he was way up there, all right? And verse 33, and he spoke of trees from the cedar that is in Lebanon, even unto hyssop, that springeth out of the wall. He spoke also of beasts and fowls and of creeping things and of fish. And so the hyssop springs up out of dry places, not well planted, well watered, that sort of thing. When hyssop grows, it doesn't grow extremely tall. It's not like a big old tree or something like that. And because the contrast here is even given, he spoke of great cedar trees and of hyssop that springs out of the wall. And basically, because it's not really very tall, you could say that it's extremely humble. It stays low. And so that means that even the shortest person, even the person of small stature, can reach it. And since it grows low, then you would have to bend down. And if you wanted to catch its fragrance, you'd have to get down low where it's at. You might not appreciate it if you're walking proudly, walking tall, you know. You might not even see it or comprehend it or understand exactly what it is, because it grows so low that you're going to have to bend down to figure it out. You're going to have to get low. And so it was a bitter herb, and is referred to as that. And the thing about it is that it was readily available anywhere. All through the Middle East, this hyssop grows everywhere. It's not uncommon. It's not a special plant. It's just a small plant that grows everywhere. Well, this is good, because God said on Passover night, here's what you do. Every one of you, head of the house, go out and get hyssop. Dip it in the blood and do this thing. Well, if there was only like five plants around there, you know, they'd all be fighting over it. But there was plenty. There's plenty. All you got to do is go out and look for it. And of course, you remember the scripture where Jesus, when he was on the cross, he said, I thirst. And with hyssop, they put a sponge on a with vinegar and lifted it up to his mouth. And, you know, I just think of the scripture that talks about Jesus as a branch. He was humble, he was low, you know, and there's a bunch of them that refer to him as the branch. In fact, Isaiah 66 talks about that, and it says, you know, unto this branch, this man, this hyssop, will I look. I will look at him that is poor and contrite of spirit. See, and that's the hyssop at work in us. So, and, you know, Jesus also, it says that Jesus was like a root that grew out of dry ground, you know. I mean, this stuff survives in the Middle East. It survives, it survives in humble settings. Hyssop refers to our humility and to our brokenness and to being of a broken and contrite heart. Over in Hebrews chapter 9, believe it or not, I'm actually skipping a bunch of scriptures that I was going to give to you. And I just thought, well, I realize that I have so much to share with you in this class that I thought I only had a little bit, and I did. But once I began to look at it, the seed sprang up, and I went, oh, my God, we might have to go to two classes. But Hebrews 9, and let's start at verse 18. Whereupon neither the first testament was dedicated without blood, For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book and all the people. Moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood is no remission. Did you notice hyssop in there? Did you know that Moses nor anybody in Israel would have missed that fact? That everything, he says, both the people and the law and the tabernacle, the book, all of it. I mean, everything, every article, he's taken hyssop because that's how you sprinkled the blood. That's how you sprinkled it. You know, there is the shedding of blood, there's the sprinkling of blood, there's a lot in all of that. But if you're going to look at the sprinkling of blood, the application of the blood, if you're going to look at it, you cannot leave hyssop out. It's there. It's required. You just don't do whatever you want, how you want, and, you know, just assume that God's going to bless it. So, again, hyssop represents the spirit in which the blood is presented to God, the way that it is presented unto God. And it speaks of that heart, that tenderness of heart. And let's face it, all the merits of God, everything that God accepts is bound up in the blood. There are no merits in the hyssop, in the sense of atonement. There are no merits. The hyssop does not cleanse you from sin, but God wants it applied with hyssop. Do you understand the two things I just said? The blood has the power. The blood is what is accepted. The blood is the thing that will wash. But God said, I want it applied with hyssop. And that's, you know, that's his requirement. And so that basically means that with God, blood is not enough. I mean, isn't that an interesting thought? Blood is not enough. Blood in itself is fine, but God wants it applied with hyssop. So let's face it. There are a lot of people who want cleansing from sin. But there are also a lot of people who never apply it with hyssop. There's no thought of hyssop. There's no thought of fulfilling an Old Testament reality. You know, it's just they ask for forgiveness and there's no humility, only faith. You understand what I'm saying? And yet God says no, not only faith with the blood. Faith is required with the blood. And we read that in Romans 3. But he requires that it be applied by the hyssop. And, you know, besides, he says, faith yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will lift you up. No, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will lift you up. And this, folks, this really relates to honoring, to committing, to resting, to all the things that we read there in Psalms. This relates to your heart and how you are towards the Lord. Lord, I want you. I want your will. I want it your way. I humble myself. I am with you. We're always, by our faith, trying to get God with us. I mean, am I right or wrong? I mean, we're always, through our faith, trying to get God with us. And that's why we've left the reality of the Passover and of the application of that blood, because that was their recognition that they're with God. When they took that hyssop, they said, I am with you, Lord. You want this. Not just you want the blood, you want it with hyssop. Not just you want the blood with hyssop, but you want it applied in the shape of a cross over the door. And I honor you. I'm with you regardless of, you know, well, this, you know, can you see somebody sitting in their home at the Passover going, well, this is a lot of extra work. What if there's no hyssop out there? What if, you know, I don't feel any hyssop? You know? You know how you're going to feel hyssop? You're going to do that by your heart for the Lord. You know? It relates to Again, all of that is not the atoning thing. Only the blood is the atoning thing. But God wants you to come in a certain way to him, to honor him, to love him, that sort of thing. And so a good example of that's found over in Luke chapter 18. Jesus gave this example, so I assume that it's going to be a good one. Luke 18. And verse 9. So here's two men going for acceptance by the blood, if you will. One's a Pharisee and the other a sinner. I want you to notice each one's attitude in applying these things. God looks at the heart. So it says, verse 9, and he spoke this parable unto certain men who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this is, you know, here's, you know, Jesus speaking. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Now, I want you to see clearly that there was no mention of hyssop here. Physical hyssop, was there? But Jesus is acknowledging the one who did it God's way. You took the blood and you applied it with hyssop, therefore you are justified more. Now, I began by saying that we think right actions, that there are righteous deeds. The deed in itself is right. If I do that deed, then I'm okay. That means that we just copy. We can just copy. We don't really have to have a change of heart, a change of being on the inside. But God's after our hearts. He's not just after robots. He's not just after parrots. He's not just after, you know, he's not just after angels who never sin. And the angels that are in heaven never do wrong. And he's still after us because he can have our heart. Because we can love him, we can. He can have our heart. And so, you know, Jesus said, that man, not just that sinner, no, that man right there, the one who's taking the blood and applying it with hyssop. He's come to me the right way, and he's putting it on his own doorpost. That man shall go down to his house justified rather than the other one. So, you know. It's that application. It's how, and that's why I said, you see, the whole thing I want you to see is hyssop was an applicator. Like if you went to the store to apply paint, you know, they've got those rollers. You got a roller and you got a handle thing that you put the roller on. And then you got the paint, and then you stick the applicator in the paint, and then you roll it on. Well, hyssop is an applicator. That's all I want you to see from that. It's how you apply it. And God would not be pleased if you went down and got a roller and applied the blood. He wants it applied with hyssop. He wants it applied with a certain spirit and a certain attitude and this sort of thing. So let's go back to David in Psalm 51. There's a lot to refer to here. Clearly, by that one verse, verse 7 in Psalm 51, David sees the correlation between the hyssop and between the blood. He wrote this psalm completely broken. He recognized what it is that God is after. And again, the occasion for this was his sin with Bathsheba. And then also the taking of Uriah Uriah's life. Well, then he was confronted by Nathan the prophet. The prophet came to him and, you know, he said, you know, you've done this thing. Well, tell you what, keep your place right here. And let me just show you something in that verse real quick. This is over in 2 Samuel. Don't lose your place in Psalm 51 because we're going to come back. 2 Samuel. We'll look at that story just for a second. Second Samuel 12. There's a lot to read here, but I think most of you know the story. But so we'll just look at a few verses. Chapter 2 Samuel 12, 1. And the Lord sent Nathan, this is Nathan the prophet, unto David. And he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. And he begins to confront David using a parable about his situation. Now look down in verse 13. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. Okay, now this is an interesting thing that we're seeing here, because David had sinned, then he got confronted by the prophet, and his immediate response was, I have sinned. And Nathan's immediate response was, you know, I've put away your sin. So, let's see. When he heard the situation, he repented, and then immediately, I want you to catch that, immediately he heard God's response, and that's, I have put away your sin. All right, now go to Psalm 51. Why would Psalm 51 be written if immediately he said, I have sinned, and God said, I put away your sin? Why would Psalm 51 be written? Think of it. I mean, you know, let's start with verse 1 of Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to thy multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgression. My sin is ever before thee. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. And then the verses that we read about, you desire truth in the inward part. Purge me with hyssop. Interesting. For most of us, when Nathan said what he said, and we said, I have sinned, and he said, okay, you're clear, that would have been the end of the matter. That would have been the end of the issue. We repented. We did our part. That's enough. But even after David hearing that the Lord had put away his sin, he sat down and wrote Psalm 51. In that psalm, he said it. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity. So, what is all that? I mean, if you didn't know better, again, you'd think that he's, you know, he's repenting again. You know what I'm saying? You might think he's not exercising faith. Especially after it was said, God has put away your sin. Because that's what Nathan said. God has put away your sin. However, that's not what's taking place in these verses right here. Instead of repenting, now David is applying the blood with hyssop. He's taking the blood himself and applying it. Was the lamb slain when Israel was in their house? Yes. Was the blood in the basin? Was the blood shed? Yes. God said, now, that's not enough. The lamb did die. The blood is shed. Now, I want you to apply it with hyssop. Psalm 51 is David taking the hyssop and he's applying it to the Lord. He's showing the Lord that he honors his way and his method of doing these things. Let's look. You know what? You really should just keep your place there in Psalm 51 because there's a good chance that I'll come back. But let's look over in 1 John real quick. 1 John, the first chapter. These are scriptures you are familiar with. 1 John 1 and verse 8. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Does that sound familiar? But the next verse says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. Now look in chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. All right, so these are examples in the New Testament of fulfilling the old, of us living in the fulfillment of the old covenant and of the Passover and of the requirements. Modern Christianity has given explanation of these scriptures, and they're based on everything but seeing Jesus as the fulfillment. It has nothing to do with Jesus and us being his body, and therefore Jesus still fulfilling these Old Testament scriptures. But within these verses, the blood is there, and it's being applied with hyssop. Prior to our confession, the great judge in the offering of Christ, he's already punished all sin 2,000 years ago. Do you agree with that? The great judge judged all sin. If that wasn't true, then every time you sin, Jesus would have to go to the cross and die again. I mean, the sin has to already be put away. The great judge took that blood and received it from the Lord, and he has punished all sin, right? In the person of Christ. In the person of Christ. And so the issue of court-appointed punishment, if you want to put it like that, the issue of court-appointed punishment is over by the time we commit the sin. It's over. And it's over before we come humbly back to the Lord over it. But to the Father, not the judge, now there's a difference. One is a judge before whom you stand condemned. The other one is a father, your father. This verse doesn't say go to the judge and he will forgive you. It says, confess that to your Father. Anybody see a difference in that? I mean, there's a big difference in that. What this person is doing is taking the blood that was shed 2,000 years ago, that is available, that is in the basin, and he's coming before the Father, and he's humbling himself, and he's just applying the blood with hyssop. And the Father is saying, you know, basically, you know, I want a relationship with you as my son. Thank you for believing in the work of the cross. I receive the finished work of the blood 2,000 years ago, and I receive your heart and your faith and your hyssop in the way that you're doing it. Basically, in other words, we are applying it to our own doorpost. You see that? We're applying the blood to our own doorpost then. Well, again, step back in time, just a few steps back. Was the lamb already slain? Yes, the lamb was slain. Was the blood already shed? Yes, it was shed. Did that end it all? No, sirree. It didn't end until the blood was applied with hyssop. Hallelujah. So the application, all we're doing is applying personally on our own doorpost the blood. And we're doing it with hyssop, just exactly the way, you know, you see that. You see examples of that in many other places. This is one place. You see examples of that in Romans. Romans chapter 1 through chapter 4 is all about the blood, is it not? It's all about the blood and, even if you go up to chapter 6, chapter 6 is so smooth. I mean, it goes, well, you know, he died for all and we're all dead and everything and it's all settled. It happened 2,000 years ago. But then you get into chapter 7 and you go, oh, wretched man that I am. I thought I was dead 2,000 years ago. Anybody understand what I'm talking about? You know, so you start going, well, what is the deal here? Chapter 6 and everything before that, in a certain sense, doesn't talk about personal application. It just talks about finished facts. It talks about settled events within the heart of the Lord. But, and you know, like I said, there's a lot of peace when you read those scriptures, isn't there? That's why some people only read those scriptures. They want to read about the lamb slain, as it were, in the backyard. They want to read about the blood shed, but they don't want to read about, well, now you need to go and apply this hyssop, with hyssop, in your own life. And Romans 7 is, this is where it's got to work in at my doorpost, at my door. It's got to become true here at my door. And so he puts us through a process that's going to bring us to using hyssop. He's going to bring us down. He's going to humble us. Amen? And, and of course it's there that you hear this cry, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me? Faith in the blood and faith in the cross is, yes, it is the most important part of it, but nothing is finished until it's applied. And it can't be applied unless you use hyssop. That's just the scriptures. All right, back to Psalm 51. I hope you kept your place there. Psalm 51 and verse 7 again. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Again, notice two different things. Purge me. Wash me. Purge me and wash me. When Nathan said to him, God has put away your sin, that was a settled fact based on, if you will, the finished work of the cross. Am I right or wrong? When David said, I have sinned, Nathan the prophet said, well, God bless you. God's put away your sin. Folks, that's a statement totally based on the finished work. But that's not the end of it, because David has not applied that. You can sit there and believe that all day long, but if you don't apply it in your own life, then, you know, it doesn't matter, you know. And washing, in one sense, can't take place until purging has taken place. So, washing is not the only factor. Purging is also necessary. And the whole psalm, Psalm 51, the whole psalm is a testimony to this broken state and to his faith in the blood. It's both things. Yes, faith in the blood. But you cannot read this psalm without realizing how incredibly tender David is to the Lord. How this lowly hyssop is at work in his life. And again, you can't smell it. You can't even get close to the hyssop unless you get low. Doesn't grow tall enough for you to be able to get to it. So David is, you know, he communicated to the Lord that he understood his desire for more than just forgiveness. More. In Hebrews, it says, in burnt offerings and sacrifices thou hast had no pleasure. Look right here. Look in verse 16. And really all around verse 16. But similar thing is taking place right here. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else I would give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise. Interesting that he's expressing a certain spirit that he feels that God is going to receive. That he said, you don't just want the blood. You don't just want sacrifices, even though that's the thing that atones. In other words, you don't just want a man to stand in his house while in the backyard the lamb's already slain and the blood's already spilt, but he never takes hyssop, he never gets low, and he never applies it to his own life. You don't want that, he said, even though it's finished, even though all atonement is there and none is in that little branch, no atonement there. God's after our heart. Thou desirest a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. So, David is, in one sense, he's partaking of the bitter herbs of the Passover. You know? Because you ate the Passover along with bitter herbs. You're swallowing the pill. In other words, it wasn't just Jesus died and he's the one who suffered. David, in a sense, if you will, David's dying here. He's eating bitter herbs right here. And he knew that the Lord desired truth in the inward parts. So, and you know, David, like all good Jews, he understood the importance of the offering and of the blood, and he acknowledges that. That's why he says, purge me, that's why he says, wash me. But he felt like on his part, not Christ in him, on his part, that the sacrifices of God also involved a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart. He refused to simply offer the blood of sacrifice without applying it with hyssop. How many of you comprehend that? You refuse to just believe in a doctrine that frees you, but the effect of it has deeply, deeply touched your life. Let me read I'm going to try to finish this part right now, so I'm just going to read a verse out of Isaiah 66. You don't have to turn there. It says, but to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my word. He that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man, and he that sacrifices the lamb as if he cut a dog's neck. He that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood. He that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delighted in their abominations. He's saying those who offer these sacrifices, if they're not poor in spirit and have a contrite heart, it's like they're not offering a sweet lamb, but a swine or a dead dog or something. Do you see that? He said, you know, we're saying, well, by faith, you know, well, just accept it, Lord, and get off my back. And he's saying, no. You need to acknowledge my son. You need to acknowledge your state and why you need me. And, you know, he says, to me, all your oblations appear as if you're offering up a dog or cutting a dog's neck off. That's what it looks like to me, because your spirit is so wrong, because you're not with me in these things, because you're not poured out, because you're not broken. I mean, that's pretty powerful stuff. The only thing that is acceptable about our sacrifice is that it represents Christ to the Father. but he wants your heart and my heart to be with him so much, so much. So this is why Jesus, you know, blesses one leper who turns back, and the other 10 God healed, but he blesses one. Were there not 10 lepers, he said, where are the 9? You see? Because he came back and he fell down and he thanked the Lord, and you know. So, and when that leper came back, what did Jesus see? He saw a healed leper. But the other guys were healed too. He saw a broken heart. He saw a tender being. He saw humility. He saw gratefulness. The other 9, they just get from God and get from God and take from God. Doesn't affect their state. In fact, it puffs them up more, makes them think that there's something more. They're healed. But their heart is not healed. They're still selfish. They're still self-centered. They're still taking and what? Receiving the judicial work of the Lord. Yes, amen. Receiving the judicial work of the Lord, but not applying it with hyssop, ignoring the hyssop. Again, let me just close with this. The value to the Lord is not in the action, but in the heart. But the true thing that atones is not the hyssop. Can you see the difference? I want to end with that to see if you can see the difference. Let's look at value on two different sides of a scale. The value of the blood as the only thing that avails and atones. Hyssop does not. The only value is in the blood. Now let's look at value from the Lord's heart as we receive that. And in that, even though it's settled, and the oblation is finished, and the sacrifice is given, and blood is shed, and it's all in the basin, it's been shed. To him now that Jesus has settled it and sat down at his own right hand, he's looking for hearts. He's not just looking for faith people. He's looking for our hearts. He's looking for the 10th leper to turn back and fall down and thank him. He's looking for the tax collector, not the Pharisee who says, well, by faith I've done this and I do this and I've done all the right deeds. The right deeds. But the tax collector said, I can't even look to heaven. David, who the prophet who just condemned him, soon as he said, I have sinned, says, don't worry, the Lord has put away your sin. And David said, that's good. That's the judicial work. I'm thankful for it. But now I've got to go pull up some hyssop. And I've got to apply this in my own life. And I've got to take it in the right spirit before the Lord. All right, let's take a break and we'll come back.